Hello, everyone. And before we start with today's show, I just wanted to remind you about the National Science Week live show presented by BrainsMatter and the Monash Science Centre. On Sunday, August the 15th, at 11 a.m. Australian Eastern Standard Time, I'll be broadcasting from the Monash Science Centre, and there's going to be a whole host of great things going on. At 11 a.m, there'll be a screening of science documentaries. At 11:30 a.m, Corin Storkey will be giving a presentation on chocolate, Brazil nuts, antioxidants, and the fight against free radicals. After that, Clive Weeks will be playing some live music, and at midday, I'll be interviewing the world-famous Professor Patricia Vickers-Rich with the theme of From Slime to Dinosaurs. Those in Melbourne, please come down and join us for a fantastic day. You can get involved, ask questions, have lunch with the paleontologist after the show, and we'll even have quizzes with prizes to be won, and a grand prize at the end for a lucky attendee. Those who aren't able to make it, the show will be streamed live via the internet. You can also participate if you have any questions or comments via Twitter. Just use the #BrainsMatter hashtag, and you might have one of your questions or comments posed to Professor Vickers-Rich. All details are on the BrainsMatter website, and you can RSVP to the Monash Science Centre or at the Facebook event. Welcome to Brains Matter, the podcast on science, curiosities, and general knowledge. I'm your host, just an ordinary guy. Hello everyone, and welcome to episode 120 of Brains Matter. Today I talk to Professor Richard Wassersug about herpetology. What's herpetology? Let's find out. I've got Professor Richard Wassersug here from Dalhousie University in Canada. He's currently at La Trobe University on a visiting professorship, so welcome to the show.
Well, thank you very much. I'm honoured to be here.
I understand that a lot of your interest in research was in tadpoles and frogs, so could you tell me a little bit about how that came about?
I was in a science program in high school back some many decades ago. And this is actually right after the data. This was shortly after the launch of Sputnik. Mm-hmm. I was living in the United States. I was born in the United States. The United States sort of went into panic mode that they were not inspiring people to go into science. So they started this program funded through the National Science Foundation of the United States to give high school students a chance to work in real research labs. And I got to work with a professor at Harvard on a fossil toad. I was a paleontologist when I started out. I'm a fossil toad from South America. I published my first paper on this toad back when I was in high school. Mm-hmm. And decided right then and there that I was going to be a paleoherpetologist, study fossil amphibians and reptiles. And throughout college, I was a science major in both geology and biology, which seemed like a solid background for paleontology. Mm-hmm. Got to graduate school, started learning about looking at the evolution of frogs. And given the various living frogs, mm-hmm. there were those people had come up with an idea of how they were related in terms of an evolutionary tree. Some people had just started looking at tadpoles, and they'd come up with a different evolutionary tree, mm-hmm. which is impossible. If you think about it, a tadpole and a frog is the same individual. Mm-hmm. And from an evolutionary perspective, they should be the same. So I started looking at recent tadpoles and looking at their morphology, and nobody had really done that in a lot of detail. Found out that if you looked inside their mouths, there were all sorts of fancy, strange structures in their mouths that could be used to discuss their relationships. Mm-hmm. And that started me off as a tadpole biologist.
Is that because the structure of the mouth doesn't change as they transform from tadpole to a frog?
No, the mouth does change. The frogs and tadpoles have very different mouths. Mm-hmm. But the tadpoles have very complicated mouths because they have to filter feed and strain tiny little things out of the water, and they need all sorts of little sieves and funnels and sensory papillae and so forth in the mouths, which is quite different than the adult frog, which catches a fly on its tongue. So there is a huge amount of change associated with metamorphosis as well. And I might add that most people who have studied tadpoles are interested in that process of metamorphosis. Mm-hmm. I came at it from a different angle. I was actually interested in the tadpoles in terms of how they lived as tadpoles. Mm-hmm. And most people at this point looked at them as very simple, uninteresting blobs that were not fully formed as frogs, and maybe they turned into something interesting later. But they hadn't looked inside them, mm-hmm. and they were really interesting inside. So that's how I got onto tadpoles. some of the tadpoles were really good at feeding in straining tiny particles out of the water, had interesting schooling behavior. So I started studying their schooling behavior. Then I noticed that some of them would come to the surface to breathe there, started studying the breathing. And over a career of about 40 years, I published about 150 papers on various aspects of the biology of tadpoles. And I guess that's how I'm most recognized as a scientist who studies polywogs. Polywogs is the North American kids' term for tadpoles.
What's your current area of research in terms of tadpoles, or have you moved on from there at the moment?
I'm still working on tadpoles. Mm-hmm. And in fact, there's aspects of this that are very relevant to the situation here in Australia, because some of the most interesting frogs in the world live here, and many of them are dying out. Mm-hmm. It turns out that many of them are infected by a fungus that attacks the mouth parts of tadpoles. Mm-hmm. So we're working, we now as myself and a couple of researchers in Tennessee, looking at exactly what happens to the mouths of these animals when the fungus attacks them. Mm-hmm. I've done a fair bit of work with high-speed video cameras, and we're looking at how a minor infection affects how they use their mouths. Mm-hmm. And we published a couple of papers on that relatively recently.
Do we understand where these infections are coming from, why there's an increase?
Well, that's another part of what we're looking at. And there's some concern that small changes in the environment, a big concern here in Australia, because water is hard to come by in a lot of the country. Mm-hmm. Small changes in the environment can really push the climate in a bad way if there's that risk. And there's some suggestion that the environment is shifting just enough to stress the tadpoles and make them more vulnerable to infections. That may or may not be true. It's an interesting hypothesis, but it's a hard one to test. Mm-hmm. Right now we're looking at essentially how this organism actually hurts the tadpoles. Because mm-hmm. Not all tadpoles have the mouth parts that are attacking these tadpoles. We don't know enough about the sort of pathology, why this is such a lethal infection. You and I have fungi on our skin right now. Mm-hmm. A person can have athlete's feet as a fungus, and it's hardly going to kill us. But for the tadpoles, it appears to be essentially the equivalent sort of situation, appears to be lethal. So we're trying to understand that. And it is a very interesting story that links to a problem here in Australia. There's also another link as well, and that is I'm interested in sort of flip side of this. We're worried about stressing tadpoles. At the same time, we have a reason to look at ways to stress tadpoles. Mm-hmm. And it turns out that the first frog I worked on, that fossil toad, happened to be the oldest known fossil cane toad. The cane toad mm-hmm. is this disastrous South America. It's a disaster that's been introduced from South America, Central America, into Australia. It's an invasive species, and it has huge numbers of tadpoles. They're toxic. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that could possibly help control them would be to come up with ways of actually stressing them. Mm-hmm. So on one hand, we're looking at animals trying to worry about tadpoles that could disappear because of an infection. Secondly, we're looking at a way to make life miserable for another group of tadpoles that don't belong here in Australia and are not particularly good for the environment or for other species. So all those questions still interest me, and I'm still doing some work in those areas.
Mm-hmm. So that's always going to be the interesting balance, isn't it? Because a lot of species have been introduced in Australia to control what was perceived to be another problem at the time, and then there was unintended consequences of all of those.
Your continent, not just your whole continent here, fascinates me. And it is amazing how paradoxically people can approach introduced species. So I went here in Melbourne, I went to this giant, large flower and garden show mm-hmm. that they have at the exhibition grounds. And it's the largest, I understand, flower and garden show in the Southern Hemisphere. And there were various flowers from all around the world there. I asked some people whether the particular plants were native or introduced, and I was actually told by one person, "Oh, well, they're naturalized." And I said, "Well, what do you mean?" And she says, "Well, they've been here for a very, very long time." These were European species introduced in the last 200 years, but this raises a problem. That is, how long do you have to have an introduced species before you accept it as normal? Mm-hmm. From the human perspective, if something's been here for six generations, it may seem like it belongs here. Mm-hmm. But clearly, this is a fascinating place for its ecological chaos right now. Mm-hmm. How it's all going to sort out and what's going to still be alive a few hundred years from now is anyone's guess. But at least it's a dynamic place, and it's fascinating to watch intellectually, even though it's a little bit scary in terms of the species that were here longest time and what their chances are surviving against all these introduced species.
So what's one of the impacts of reduced number of frogs in the ecosystem? So obviously this kind of infection is going to reduce the number of frogs that are transformed out of these tadpoles. So what's an ecological
That's a good point. You're sort of asking me, you know, what is the ecological role of frogs in general?
Yeah.
Certainly, I can't speak for all of Australia because you have such a huge continent. And you have very different organisms and different climates in the northeast versus the southwest of this country. However, amphibians in general and frogs particularly are pest control organisms on insects. Ironically, that's one of the reasons why some species have been introduced. We don't know enough about that, really. There's just not enough work done on the ecology of frogs. They're cryptic species, so it's hard to know how many are in any particular place without knowing what their density is. Mm-hmm. You really can't calculate the amount of control on them. It's almost impossible to know, for instance, on birds and mammals that might prey on frogs and tadpoles, to how important they are in the diet at any particular time. You'd have to actually be looking at stomach contents. You'd have to kill off a fair number of their predators or potential predators to actually get a sense for how crucial they are within the ecosystem. However, the answer, I would say, is not to the concern of, to the question, should I be concerned, how important are they to the environment? I'm reminded of concerns about the how pesticides like DDT were taking down the American eagle. Mm-hmm. And my answer is, if you can't keep a predator alive, what makes you think you can keep your own species alive? And I think any species that is, and particularly a whole group of species, in this case, the amphibians aren't just one species. There's many. If you can't keep them whole class or order of vertebrates alive, that's a really bad sign about how well you can stabilize your own environment. So yeah, I'm concerned. I think we should all be concerned, independent of whether they are what we'd call keystone species or not.
And now it's time for Listener of the Episode. And today's Listener of the Episode is Jason Haymeister from Sydney in Australia. Thanks for your support, Jason. Now back to the interview.
Going back to the cane toads that you were mentioning earlier, I heard something not that long ago about a particular possum that could eat the cane toad and suffer no ill effects.
This is where the cane toad is not only an introduced species, but it's evolving and predators are incorporating into their own ecosystem. So, for instance, a cane toad's in theory are edible if you flip them over and open them up from the belly. Mm-hmm. The toxic or glands are on their backs. So we are likely to see an evolving number of species that will start to be able to eat them. Mm-hmm. And you'll end up with changes. But that doesn't necessarily help the environment particularly.
No.
And you don't know what the costs are going to be to them. They may be able to eat them, but they may just have a slight reduction in the number of offspring that they have or survive. Mm-hmm. Because it costs them more to process the toxins and less energy that can be provided to their young. Mm-hmm. So even though you might see a single predator, a native predator, start to take on an introduced species, you need to watch it for several generations before you can conclude that this is a benign incorporation of the introduced species into the ecosystem.
And how do you see the way frogs and toads as being portrayed in the media? I know that a lot of people consider them, I guess most amphibians and reptiles, to be a bit scary or slimy.
Australia's famous for having outrageously toxic snakes. What I'm intrigued by is that most of those are actually fairly benign. Mm-hmm. That is, considering their abundance, they don't attack people particularly aggressively. People have to really bump into them. The frogs get sort of thrown in this group of frogs and toads and snakes is all the territory of what we call herpetology. And the herpetological animals are indeed seen as sort of vermin, mm-hmm. even if they're not venomous around the world. But we know that that's a little unfair for a fair number of them. It's also true that we know that they can be very important in pest control. Mm. For instance, some of these poisonous snakes are in other parts of the world really do keep the rodents in control, and the rodents can carry some fairly serious diseases. So they have a very important ecological context. My impression is, and I invite people if they haven't seen it, is to go see the original cane toad movie that was done by Mark Lewis. It's a famous movie, about 25 years old now. Mm-hmm. And there's actually a 3D version of that movie that's recently been done. And it actually is more about the sort of mixed culture of Australia, where you have people who range from truly loving animals that most people wouldn't love to people who will kill an animal that most people don't love, but for no reason at all. So you can see extremes. And the cane toad has produced that. I mean, people who've sort of seen it now as emblematic. And interesting, and since it's been here, they're viewing it as a naturalized and something that perhaps should be allowed rights to live here, as most Europeans, mm-hmm. And most people from elsewhere in the world see themselves as, after a generation or two or three, as naturalized enough to be part of the fauna of Australia. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, those people who see it as the most obnoxious animal around and will kill any and everyone that they can see. We really don't know. And you asked a good question about its predators and whether and where it fits into the ecosystem. We are ourselves an introduced species. If we're going to be, and we are the most dangerous introduced species in Australia, if we're going to simply say all introduced species are evil, then we are evil by just being here. That's a starting point. I think we really have to be concerned with sort of a long-term look at an unstable ecosystem. And to make matters complicated, with growing evidence of climate change, that's right. It's an incredibly dynamic and involving and chaotic sort of system. We do need to be watching it as a sense of, for our own selves, of when things are or not beyond our control. And particularly dangerous. Mm-hmm. We do have to be concerned about how new species interact with the environment. Mm-hmm. I think even if without assuming necessarily that they're absolutely benign, mm-hmm. or absolutely deadly, the fact is they're here. We need to understand how they interact.
And there's a wide range of shapes and sizes for different types of frogs and toads and so on. You mentioned your initial interest was through paleontology. Have the frogs that you studied back then, have they changed in size from millennia ago to now in general? So we have this perception that back in the age of the dinosaurs, animals were a lot larger and they're smaller now.
Yeah, that's true for the dinosaurs, but at the same time, the dinosaurs, when they were the largest animals on the planet, there were also lots of little animals. Little frogs and the beginning of the mammals were all small animals. But it is generally true that if a taxonomic group lasts long enough, it will often evolve to some level of giantism. That certainly happened in the ancient amphibians even before the time of the dinosaur. So you have giant amphibians looking like giant salamanders that were on this planet. They were that before the reptiles really came into their own, before the mammals came to their own. The frogs have survived a long time, probably by not evolving towards giantism and being the dominant giant species. If you think about it, the big whales are in trouble. Mm-hmm. The dinosaurs got very big and were in trouble. And the giant amphibians that were around in the Permian are no longer here. There was the small ones that hung around. So to answer a specific question, there's not a lot of evidence of evolution towards giantism, mm-hmm. in the frogs that we have now. Their relatives that we can find fossils for at the end of the time of the dinosaurs are about the same size as most of them.
Okay.
So giantism has not happened quite like it did for the dinosaurs.
And I'll just finish up on an unusual question. I understand with one of your research projects you got students to lick.
No, we did not. No. We did not get students to lick. We got them to put them in their mouth, chew them up, and spit them out. So I seem to be famous for one small little project that I did way back when I was a graduate student. I took a tropical jungle biology course in Costa Rica. We had like 3 or 4 days to do a student independent project. And I was interested in tadpoles already then, started my thesis work on tadpoles. And I noticed that as I was trying to find tadpoles in Costa Rica, some of them were incredibly easy to find. The classic one was the cane toad. They have thousands of tadpoles, and they form big, flat, huge mats of tadpoles with tens of thousands of tadpoles, often in a big sort of shoal or school, in shallow water, clear water, where you could see them from dozens of meters away, and they were easy to catch and easy to collect. Other tadpoles, you could sit with a little tea strainer going around turning rocks in a stream, hunting for hours to find two or three. And I thought, well, there's got to be some way that those toad tadpoles were protecting themselves. And I thought they must be unpalatable. Mm-hmm. So with the bribe of beer, I invited my fellow grad students all to do a tadpole tasting session with me. We got enough students, I got enough students, and enough different tadpoles to show that, in fact, the tadpoles that were easy to find, easy to see, like the cane toad tadpoles, tasted terrible. Okay, and the tadpoles that were very difficult to find, very difficult to see, but I wouldn't say they tasted sweet, but they certainly were not
as bad.
bad tasting at all. They were sort of tasteless, but at least they would be adequate as a food source. And that sort of affirms a general principle for natural history. Basically, you have to have multiple defenses, mm-hmm. or you have to be cryptic.
Yeah.
If you can't, you have to either be able to run fast, be toxic if you're going to hold your ground, mm-hmm. or be difficult to see. And the species that are easy to see taste terrible or are hard to catch.
Isn't evolution wonderful?
Evolution, I think, is fascinating, and yes, I think it's wonderful.
Finally, are you a fan of Kermit the Frog?
Am I a fan of Kermit the Frog? I'm not a big fan of frogs that are seen as decorative. It bothers me somewhat that some people think that every decorative frog should have a crown on the head and be a prince that's waiting to be kissed. On the other hand, I play the banjo a little bit, so does Kermit, so I appreciate that. I actually like Kermit's sense of humor.
Mm-hmm.
There's a certain deadpan wryness to Kermit as a character. I guess, you know, it's a very good question to expand upon it. I started this project a long time ago and never followed up on it, but I went through lots and lots of kids' books to see how many of them had amphibians and reptiles with natural characteristics of the amphibians and reptiles. Can't claim that Kermit does much for our understanding of frogs, other than having a somewhat frog-like morphology.
The fact that he eats flies.
And he eats flies. I think that would be nice if more of the stories that involved frogs and toads had the frogs and toads having more toad or frog-like traits and properties.
Mm-hmm.
Kermit doesn't have a lot of them. So in that sense, you know, I find it entertaining, but I don't want the public or kids to be confused by thinking, well, Kermit's around, frogs are doing fine, I don't have to worry about them.
Exactly.
They should understand the reality of species. And perhaps we have more cartoon characters than real animal characters that the public and the kids can get associated with. That's a bit of a problem. I don't think. I guess I'd love to see it if Kermit was a little more concerned about the declining and disappearing amphibians.
Mm-hmm.
He could be a spokesperson for that, but he isn't yet.
All right, Hints and Associates. There's a tip for you.
Right,
Professor Richard Wassersug. Thank you very much for your time today.
Well, thank you. It's been a pleasure being here.
Kermit the Frog here. Thanks, Ordinary Guy, for having a show about my relatives.
Well, I hope you enjoyed the show. Just a few comments before we finish up today. Of course, I'll remind you again of the live show this weekend. Be there if you can. For those who have an iPhone or iTouch, the BrainsMatter application has been updated. So if you want that, go to the BrainsMatter website and you'll find a link showing where you can find it. And I'd like to thank every single one of you who voted for BrainsMatter in the National Science Week's Big Blog Theory competition. which is a federal government initiative to find Australia's best science communicators. There were two categories, blogging and microblogging. Brainsmatter managed to get in as a finalist in the microblogging category, and to my huge surprise, Brainsmatter was runner-up. So thank you to whichever of you nominated me, and of course to everyone who voted. And a big congratulations to Beck for winning the blogging category, and to Corey who won the microblogging category. And semi-regular guest on Brainsmatter, Mr. Science himself, Mark West, was runner-up in the blogging category as well. So listeners, you're in good hands here. And on that note, I'd like to leave you with a quote from David Brin. It is said that power corrupts, but actually it's more true that power attracts the corruptible. The sane are usually attracted by other things than power. Bye for now. Thanks for listening to the show. You can check out the Brainsmatter website at www.brainsmatter.com. That's www.brainsmatter.com. And you can find all the other episodes of the show there. Just click on the podcast link on the right hand side. You can listen to the episodes from your browser by choosing Flash Player from the links and selecting whichever episode you want to hear from within the player. There's also other information on the site, such as links to articles and news, subscription details, both via iTunes and manually, and voting information. Please vote for the podcast on Podcast Alley, and remember to vote every month, since the votes reset at the start of each month. If you want to support the show, have a look at the Support the Show link. You can make a donation via PayPal, or you can buy a book through one of the Amazon links on the support page. If you have any comments or suggestions, you can leave an entry on this episode's show notes on the webpage, or you can send me an email. All my contact information can be found on the site. The theme music Future is performed by Cut Copy and comes courtesy of Glenn Gertz from Modular Records. I hope you enjoyed the show. Bye for now.